Beacon Press Audio presents Jesus and the Disinherited by Howard Thurman. This audiobook is narrated by Leon Nixon. Published by Beacon Press Audio, 2022.
Foreword to the 2022 edition. From the day my son was born, I told him every morning, "You are a child of God. God loves you. There is no one greater than you but God." I knew that my son would be growing up in a society that would despise him for his blackness. Therefore, I wanted to provide him with that part of black faith that would not allow a piece of the white racist anti-blackness of the world in which he would grow up to be implanted deep within him. The morning conversations I had with my young son reflect the conversations black parents have had with their children across generations so as to protect their souls and personalities from being destroyed by a society that does not respect their humanity. It is the conversation that Langston Hughes so intimately captures in the poem Mother to Son. "So, boy, don't you turn back. Don't you set down on the steps, 'cause you finds it's kinda hard." It is the conversation James Baldwin has when he writes his nephew on his 14th birthday. "Please try to remember that what they believe, as well as what they do and cause you to endure, does not testify to your inferiority, but to their inhumanity and fear." And it is the conversation that Howard Thurman engages in his book, Jesus and the Disinherited. For some, Thurman's book perhaps represents one mystic's attempt to capture the inner spiritual strivings of Jesus. For others, it may exemplify theological liberalism's overemphasis on the historical Jesus as a great exemplar and role model for humans to follow. And for still others, Thurman's book is a precursor to 20th century black theologians' declaration that Jesus was black. While each of those renderings undoubtedly captures an aspect of the theological significance of Jesus and the Disinherited, they do not capture its timeless meaning and why it continues to speak to us more than 70 years after it was written. What Langston Hughes captured through poetry and James Baldwin in a letter, Howard Thurman captures through a testimony of his faith. Jesus and the Disinherited represents nothing less than those conversations black parents must have with their children in a world that denies the created sacredness of their black humanity. In fact, this book is grounded in conversations between Howard Thurman and the black women who raised him, his grandmother and mother. Through these conversations, Thurman was provided with the working paper that would put him out of the immediate clawing reaches of the tense or sustained negations of his environment, thus allowing him to grow up with soaring hopes and a healthy personality. That working paper is Jesus. True to the faith of his grandmother and mother, Thurman proclaims that Jesus, a poor non-Roman Jew, knew intimately what it meant to be a member of a minority group in the midst of a larger, dominant, and controlling group. Therefore, Thurman declares, the teachings and the life of Jesus have something special to say to those who stand at a moment in human history with their backs against the wall. Even as Thurman recognizes that Christianity has been used throughout history as an instrument of oppression, he makes clear that Christianity, as it was born in the mind of Jesus, appears as a technique of survival for the oppressed. With this understanding, Thurman goes on to provide a theological testimony of faith concerning the one who announced the good news that fear, hypocrisy, and hatred, the three hounds of hell that track the trail of the disinherited, need have no dominion over those with their backs against the wall. And so, it is through conversations such as those with his mother concerning his fear of Halley's Comet, or with his grandmother about her enslaved life, that Thurman explains how Jesus faced down those hellhounds, providing the disinherited with an example to follow for doing the same. In so doing, Thurman also provides profound theological insight into the already not yet reality that is the kingdom of God, reflected in the teachings and life of Jesus. On the one hand, it is that not yet future defined by God's love that is the focus of Jesus' teachings. It is this future kingdom of God that Christians are obliged to work toward making a reality within our society and world. On the other hand, it is the already future that Jesus embodies and witnesses to in his life. His is a life in which, as Thurman explains, the love ethic is central. It is this love ethic that ultimately conquers the hounds of fear, hypocrisy, and hatred. Essentially, Thurman lifts up the kingdom of God that is Jesus as the exemplary working paper that will enable the disinherited to live in their present with dignity and creativity. As Thurman does this, the profound nature of Jesus' relationship to the disinherited becomes even more clear. For the Jesus at the center of the faith handed down to Thurman from his grandmother and mother is one who not only stands in solidarity with the disinherited in their struggle for freedom from social oppression, but most significantly, he is one who shares their very feelings of growing up in a society that has made no provisions for them, and thus in living day by day without a sense of security. I have faced racism time and time again, but it's hard. When you have to see your child upset because he knows he's being treated different than a white child, said a black mother whose son was not allowed to enter a Baltimore, Maryland restaurant for wearing an outfit similar to one that a white boy was wearing who was welcomed into the restaurant. As I heard this mother's words, I thought of the ongoing conversations she would have with her son. And I thought of the conversation that is Jesus and the disinherited. This book provides a message to black children on how to thrive and flourish in a world that attempts to destroy their humanity from the inside out. It is in this way that Howard Thurman's book is timeless as the conversations between black parents and their children. The Very Reverend Kelly Brown Douglas, Ph.D.
Foreword to the 1996 edition. A superficial encounter with the title of Howard Thurman's classic statement, Jesus and the Disinherited, could easily lead us to anticipate a 1940s version of liberation theology, with its now familiar message that God is on the side of the oppressed, with its powerful and prophetic condemnation of the oppressors and their cruel systems of dehumanization, with its urgent calls to repentance, resistance, and hope. But nothing in Thurman's large and magnificently varied body of work ever yielded itself to superficial readings, and this invaluable half-century-old text is no exception. For although it is possible to glean elements of a liberation theology from its pages, this richly endowed, seminal work can be more accurately and helpfully described as a profound quest for a liberating spirituality, a way of exploring and experiencing those crucial life points where personal and societal transformation are creatively joined. It is the centerpiece of the Black prophet mystic's lifelong attempt to bring the harrowing beauty of the African-American experience into deep engagement with what he called the religion of Jesus. Ultimately, his goal was to offer this humanizing combination as the basis for an emancipatory way of being, moving toward a fundamentally unchained life that is available to all the women and men everywhere who hunger and thirst for righteousness, especially those who stand with their backs against the wall. Stating his central intention in a slightly different way, early in the book, Thurman said that he had written for those who need profound succor and strength to enable them to live in the present with dignity and creativity. Still, the great teacher, preacher, and sage never strayed far from his basic urgent metaphor of the wall. Repeatedly, he announced that he was attempting to explore and explain what the teachings of Jesus have to say to those who stand at a moment in human history with their backs against the wall, the poor, the disinherited, the dispossessed. In essence, he was surveying the world of the oppressed and asking how it might be possible for human beings to endure the terrible pressures of the dominating world without losing their humanity, without forfeiting their souls. For Thurman, this project was no distanced, merely intellectual task. Of course, no work of his ever took on that character. At the outset, he made it clear that his interest in the issues has been and continues to be both personal and professional. Born into the black community of Daytona Beach, Florida, at the beginning of the century, he was carefully nurtured by a maternal grandmother who had come through the fierce crucible of slavery while leaning on the Lord. So Thurman possessed an intimate knowledge of the harsh contours and consequences of America's walls, as well as a profound appreciation for the amazing inner resources of those people who had stood firmly against the hardness without losing their humanity or betraying their souls. And there was never any doubt in his mind that the life and teachings of Jesus, the poor Jew of Nazareth, the disinherited, threatened subject of Roman power, were especially relevant to the ever-present contingent of black men and women who lined the serrated, cutting surfaces of the wall called America. So he could unhesitatingly declare that the striking similarity between the social position of Jesus in Palestine and that of the vast majority of American Negroes is obvious to anyone who tarries long over the facts. Thurman had been tarrying over and wrestling with these urgent matters for most of his adult life. He took the concerns with him when he left Florida in 1919 to attend Morehouse College in Atlanta, and was able to discuss them with fellow students such as Martin Luther King Sr., faculty members such as Benjamin E. Mays and E. Franklin Frazier, and the visionary president of the school, John Hope. The issues and questions were.
We hope you enjoyed this preview. To continue listening to this audiobook on Google Play Books, use the link in the video description.